I'm Don Denman, the host of today's talk, and I just want to do a brief introduction to get us started. When I do job interviews, I sometimes ask the candidate, what would you do if you won the lottery? If you could do anything you wanted with your life, how would you spend your time? I think it's really interesting to see how this exposes what people feel is deeply important. When I first met today's speaker, Aragon, he seemed like the kind of person that could do anything. And it's been really interesting to watch him slowly realize that he didn't want to spend his time working at a high-tech startup, that what he really wanted to do with his life was to teach kids science. Why is helping kids learn math and science so deeply important right now? Here to give you that perspective and to show you how you can each participate is Aragon Burlingham and Dina Moskowitz of We Teach Science. Thank you.
Thanks for the kind words, Don. It's a pleasure to be here today, and thanks for setting all this up as well. So as Don mentioned, I'm an engineer by training, aerospace engineering. I spent about 15 years in Silicon Valley working at design consultancies, primarily in the research and development role. My specialty was data analysis, so that's kind of the angle I came from. But through all of that, I mentored kids. I spent some time at lunch working with kids at local middle and high schools to help them get better at math and science. 2 years ago, I decided, as Don alluded, to step away from all of that and really focus on this effort full time. So we'll talk about that in a little bit and about the program we're doing. But the one thing I wanted to share with you today before we start everything is to really put this in the context of why this is important. Imagine showing up for work your first day at Google and being told that 2 out of every 3 people that start at the beginning of this work year will have failed 12 months from now. Imagine hearing that at the beginning of your first day of work. And that's effectively what's happening with kids in algebra. Only 1 out of 3 are meeting the state standards after their first year of introduction to the subject. So it's truly shocking. It's something that not many people are aware of, and it's a real problem. So what are we trying to do to fix that? We're not getting involved in and with the schools, but what we're doing is providing mentors, people like yourselves, and pairing them up with a student for the entire academic year, and to help them explore math and really see it through the eyes of an engineer. You all have this approach, we all do, of looking at the world through engineering eyes and marvel at it every day. It's something we take for granted, but a lot of kids never have that. They don't have the parents, necessarily, that are fired up in that way. They may not have brothers and sisters. So the only chance they get to learn math and science each day is with that teacher. And so that's what we're working on. So the final piece I'll add before Dina steps in is how we came to this final model of remote mentoring. Initially, we started by trying to get software engineers like Don into the classroom for 1 hour a week to work with the kids, but we found it's just too far. It's too hard, too far to go. It's too difficult. And so we moved to a remote mentoring model where you literally just stay at your desk and you're able to connect with your students. So I'm going to step away at this point and let Dina talk to you about the details of the program. Dina came on board in March. She comes to us with an experience from a teaching background, and she herself also wanted to reach out to many more students than you would do within one particular class. So come on up, Dina, and walk us through the program. Thank you.
Hello. Feels a little funny to be on a microphone. Okay. So my name's Dina Moskowitz. I'm the program manager at We Teach Science, which means I kind of recruit and train and support mentors as they provide this kind of this product to students over the course of the school year. And we're right at the beginning of our second pilot right now. School starts next week, and we're hoping to have the program up and running in about a month. So first of all, how are California students doing in math? Great. Kind of in the middle. Kind of not so great. Not so great. A little bit of somewhat positive news came out of the most recent STAR tests in general that just said we've done slightly better. But in general, we're not doing real well. And as Aragon talked about, specifically in algebra, we're really not doing well. You know, not even half of our students are passing. As a state, we're pretty low. Right now, I believe we're number 46 or so on our state tests compared to the rest of the states. And then this is what Aragon was talking about specifically. If you break it down by county, I don't know if I have a laser dealio here, but you'll notice Santa Clara County is that dark red, so they're sort of somewhat in the middle. Alameda is kind of moving down. In general, though, we're around, as a state, a third of our students. So this is disturbing, and especially being here at Google, we need people who are strong in math and science, right? So what we're doing is something called the Remote Tutoring and Mentoring Program. Aragon kind of explained it. You connect from your desk, and it's each week, and you have the same student. And your goal is to kind of take this child who's excited about math. It's at one point, you know, early on in its career, and as they slowly kind of around eighth grade, they're not getting nearly as excited, and to kind of bring that back out in them and that excitement for, oh my goodness, what can I do? Because as you guys know, math is really not just about being able to pass a test or to, you know, it's really about creating solutions to problems and understanding the way things work and all these other things. And so if we don't have good creative critical thinkers, we're not going to be able to get there. So I'm going to show you an example. I'm hoping it's going to work. Ah, hold on one second. It is working, but I'm not connected with sound.
If you guys are up for it, then
so
I'll
this is an example of one of our sessions.
Sounds good.
Okay. And I'll explain things that may not be as obvious. So Dan Boyle, defenseman for the San Jose Sharks, and Brian Campbell.
So what we have here is a web-based
and former San Jose Shark.
You want to turn that down a bit?
Are skating around during warm-ups.
Yeah, let's pause it real quick.
And they
So what we have here is a web-based whiteboard. So basically the students at the end of the school day will go to the library and they'll log on to their computers and sign on to our, go through our portal to this web page. And you'll see here we've got the names up on the left, their mentors waiting for them. And basically they can't see each other. We've got video capability, but we've been asked to turn that off by the schools. But as you can hear, they're talking to each other and they share this whiteboard space where they can draw and see what each other are writing. So it's really like you guys at work standing up by one of the whiteboards back there and exploring and sharing ideas. So with that in mind, we'll just carry on here.
So just to give a little, this is a session that a mentor had come up with a hockey problem. She's really into hockey, and the Sharks were in, I believe it was the quarterfinals at the time, and kind of created what they call a mixture problem out of kind of something she had seen or thought of when she was watching hockey.
If you guys are up for it, then I'll
show
read you my problem.
A couple minutes and then
sounds good.
Okay. And I'll explain things that may not be as obvious. So Dan Boyle, defenseman for the San Jose Sharks, and Brian Campbell, defenseman for the Blackhawks and former San Jose Shark, are skating around during warm-ups. And they happen to look up and see each other while they're both on their own goal lines. And they give each other a look and simultaneously take slap shots aimed at each other. If Dan Boyle has a slap shot at 95 miles an hour and Brian Campbell has a slap shot at 90 miles an hour, at what time do the pucks pass each other?
Oh yay, mixture problem.
So what if we split this down the middle so that you guys can both work on it?
Okay.
and then one of you work on one side and one of you work on the other, but at the same time, we can all talk about it. So the first question would be is, what time do the pucks pass each other? The next one is, okay, where do they pass each other?
Oh, okay.
And it's possible you may not have exactly enough information.
Okay.
So if you don't, let me know.
We don't know how long the field is, or not the field, the ring.
Exactly. So how it start setting up the problem?
Okay, so so it goes on and they continue, they each kind of work it out. One of the things that I feel like this really shows is, A, we're using a concept that they've learned in class and really applying it to a new situation, and B, that each student is coming up with how to solve the problem on their own and not being led through. I think very often we're very quick as, you know, teachers and mentors and supporters to try to just get a student to the right answer. And the real goal is put out information and let them quell kind of what they can from it and where they should start, and then kind of support them as they go. So that's kind of what we're trying to do. We're working in this remote setting. It's every week with the same student. And over the course of the year, you develop this relationship where you're hoping students are asking questions and being active participants in this to sort towards their own learning. We have actually a few more statistics that are up here, so all at this point, but we're still in the process of gathering data from our first pilot. It's very small amounts of data, so we're just not making any statements really yet until our researchers from Stanford get back to us. But here's some really basic things. Our students did slightly better on district tests without normed analysis. They also did slightly better on the STAR tests, also without a normed analysis, so I can't. But we're pretty sure they've done a little bit better on the math STAR state test this year. They were really positive. We interviewed all the students at the end of the year. Almost all of them were really, really positive about it. 61% had a parent who didn't graduate from college, and that came from their demographic data that they give to the school. So it's clear that there's definitely a need, that they need people in their lives to support them and help them. 57% of our students were female, and we had one female mentor. So we're really looking to bring on more female mentors, and we do have some more that are coming on for this year. Their grades went up pretty significantly from their seventh grade third trimester to their third trimester. This one student, number 21, her grades went down, and it was pretty clear she wasn't really, her kind of interest in school kind of waned over the course of the year, and she wasn't really very interested in A, school, or B, mentoring. So unfortunately, she did not do better. But these students in red were some of our focal students that I was kind of watching, who were really struggling in seventh grade and did quite a bit better in eighth grade, so that was great to see, and many students did a little bit better. This is what it looks like at our on our whiteboard. This is a screenshot of one of the of our website, and you know, each mentor has their name, and the students would click on their mentor's name, and then it pulls up that page that you saw in the video. So our goals with this, our basic goals are, you know, standardized test score improvements and grade test score improvements, but those are just kind of the beginning. We're really hoping to kind of improve their concepts of math and their understanding of the application. Willingness to take risks is a huge one, and as you guys probably know, you have to be willing to try out different things even if you're not sure it's right. Asking good questions are all really important to being strong mathematicians. So, if you are interested, there are a few steps to go through hearing this information session. We do kind of a short phone call to kind of make sure that you understand kind of what you're getting into and give us a sense of who you are so I can match you with a good student. Everybody who works with kids in California needs to be fingerprinted. There's a little bit of paperwork. So I didn't fix that. There's an orientation actually on the 18th. And then ongoing, you meet with your students once a week. And we try to have workshops once every 3 months or so. This last one, Scientist in the Classroom, is we're hoping to bring in one of our mentors to each class once a month. So not all of our mentors will do it, but come in and have kind of a conversation with students and talk about kind of what you do in your work, or it could be something that you're just really passionate and excited about, anything that kind of has to do with math and science in the real world. And these are all companies of people that, mentors that we have on board, some more than others. Right now we have one Google mentor, Don, and we're hoping to have more. And then there's a number of other companies that we've managed to bring at least one mentor on. If there's any questions?
I just wanted to touch base on a couple of things here. The whiteboard session that you saw there with Helen, the kids are fed problems where you're given all the information you need except one piece, and you're asked to solve for that every time. And I think we all know that's not how the real world operates. You've got to go in, actually asking the question is the hardest part, and then researching it and knowing what information to throw out and what to keep, and then working towards a solution. And this is a key skill that I think can't be taught early enough. So by working with these engineers, with people like you, they really get a handle on that from the get-go. And it's absolutely critical. As you've seen with the scores and how the kids are doing, it's not looking good. And one of the things we didn't mention here is algebra is considered a gateway to tertiary education. If you fail in algebra in eighth grade, there's a good chance down the road that you're not going to be getting into university. And not getting a degree has been tied to all kinds of things. You know, the income you'll earn over your lifetime, your health, many different things. So this is really, we're focusing on algebra right now because it's a key gateway to the program. The final piece I'll add is this is the pilot that we're doing right now is the second in a series of three. Our first pilot last year was 23 students. This year we have 100 students. And then next year, a year from now, we're going to have 500 students throughout the Bay Area. So we're growing at a rate of about 4x right now. And that's it. Do you have anything else to add, Dina?
Of course. Could you comment a little bit about the science part?
Yes, absolutely. So right now, we are called We Teach Science Foundation. We decided to focus on algebra at the beginning because it's more clearly defined both in the textbooks and how it's taught and the information that's transferred to the kids. What we did in our first year was just focus on algebra. What we'll be doing this year is tying in with the teachers and letting the mentors know what's being covered in the science class each week. So what we do is we encourage our mentors to track that, and there's a quick sentence at the beginning of every week that says, hey, your kid this week is doing this in science and this in math, and to really tie it in. We also have access to the textbooks online for both subjects, and those are available to all the mentors. As we develop and we figure out this mentoring model of taking subject matter experts like yourselves and creating strong mentors, we will expand into science in a more traditional way, like we've done with algebra.
Are you funded exclusively by the sponsoring companies, or what? Do you have other
sources? Oh, how is it funded?
Yeah.
So funding comes. We're a 501c3. Funding comes from three sources. We've got individuals, corporate America, and foundations. So predominantly over the past 2 years, we've had our greatest support, about 80% from individuals. Both foundations and corporate America tend to hold back until a program is well established before they start volunteering or giving money. So we're at that crest right now where that's starting to change. As you can see with these companies up here, we've really crossed that barrier at this point with corporate America, and some of these companies are actually providing dollars with their employees to fund the work. And then finally, on the foundations, they're getting a lot more interested now that we have our first year behind us and we'll be presenting data to them. So we'll be doing a roadshow in the next month or so, presenting to all the Bay Area foundations for more funding. Good question. Thank you. Anything else? Great. Well, thanks to all of you for listening. Don, thank you so much for all the effort in getting this set up. I really appreciate it. And we look forward to hearing from you.